Isn't it true that being concerned about having enough capital to meet deposit requirements, isn't that a liquidity problem? Or could you just answer yes or no?
Chairwoman Waters, I appreciate the opportunity to address that.
Just yes or no?
We always felt comfortable with our liquidity and the additional capital that Robinhood raised.
Please answer yes or no.
We always felt comfortable
with our liquidity. I have to get through my 5 minutes. I don't have time. I just need a yes or no answer.
I stand by my statement. The additional capital we raised wasn't to meet capital requirements or deposit requirements.
The gentleman.
Excuse me.
I'm reclaiming my time.
Do you think you owe your customers more disclosure and transparency than you gave them? And second, do you believe your lack of candor with your customers might have contributed to the wild speculation and confusion that resulted in the aftermath of your trading restrictions?
Congresswoman, I appreciate the question. So to answer the second question, look, I'm sorry for what happened. I apologize, and I'm not gonna say that Robinhood did everything perfect and that we haven't made mistakes in the past, but what I commit to is making sure that we improve from this, we learn from it, and we don't make the same mistakes in the future.
First of all, is that $35 billion, is that gross or net? In other words, is that actual profit or does it include margin shares, other forms of leverage that may actually not belong to the account holder?
It does include, Congressman, unrealized gains. So it's the value of assets, both including positions in securities and cryptocurrencies.
Okay, I get that. I get that. But again, $35 billion doesn't mean anything to me unless you can convert that into a rate of return. So do that for me. What is that on what asset under management number is that $35 billion unrealized against?
The asset under management number is not one that Robinhood has publicly shared.
Okay, but you can't share $35 billion. Sorry, Mr. Tenev, I just don't have a lot of time. $35 billion is a meaningless number. I need to know what that is in terms of return. So convert that for me into rate of return so I can compare it to Treasury, so I can compare it to the S&P 500.
Congressman, with respect, I think the proper comparison is to customers not investing at all. Much of our customers are investing for the first time and are taking money that they otherwise would have spent or consumed and putting it in.
Mr. Tenev, again, I don't want to be rude, but it's my time. Again, you offered up the $35 billion number, which as you and anybody else schooled in finance knows is meaningless unless you convert it into a rate of return.
The sheer scope of today's hearing is right there in the title, Game Stopped. Who wins and loses when short sellers, social media, and retail investors collide? And collide they did. Each side has its own take on what happened and what should come next. Hedge funds like Ken Griffin's Citadel Securities says they're not the bad guy.
We simply play by the rules of the road. Payment for order flow has been expressly approved by the SEC. It is a customary practice within the industry. If they choose to change the rules of the road, we need to drive on the left side versus the right side. That's fine with us. I do believe that payment for order flow has been an important source of innovation in the industry. As the CEO of Robinhood has testified, they drove the industry towards $0 commissions. This has been a big win for American investors.
And just to be clear, the CEO of Citadel, Ken Griffin speaking there, the hedge fund Citadel, and the market maker, of course, is Citadel Securities. Now, Robinhood's CEO was asked why his platform suddenly restricted buying stocks like GameStop, but not selling them. He says heavy trading volume forced his hand.
The decision to restrict GameStop and other securities was driven purely by deposit and collateral requirements imposed by our clearing houses. So, buying securities collateral requirements. Selling does not. Even though I recognize customers were very upset and disappointed that we had to do this, I imagine it would have been significantly worse if we prevented customers from selling.
And there were lots of those kind of interruptions. Finally, Reddit CEO told lawmakers that his platform is doing all it can to keep its users honest.
What steps is your company taking to guard against this? Anything at all?
Congressman, we spend a lot of time at Reddit ensuring the authenticity of our platform. So we've got a large team dedicated to this exact task. Everything on Reddit, all of the content is created by users, voted on by users, and ranked by users. And we make sure that that is authentic and as unmanipulated as possible. And in this specific case, we did not see any signs of manipulation.
CNN business lead writer Matt Egan has been watching these lively hearings all afternoon. Matt, talk us through, what were the key lines for you?
Well, Julia, I think coming into this, we didn't really know who the bad guy, as you put it, was in the view of Congress. But I think at this point, it's pretty clear. They see the bad guy as Robinhood. I've been taken aback by how Vlad Tenev, the CEO of Robinhood, has really received the lion's share of questions and criticism and the most intense lines of questioning from lawmakers. They've quizzed him over, yes, the controversial trading restrictions that they imposed at the end of January, but also their communications issues and even their business model. At one point, Vlad Tenev, he did acknowledge under some questioning from lawmakers that, listen, you know, they have made mistakes. He did apologize for their communications issues. But if you're Robinhood, I think the biggest concern is how often payment for order flow came up in this hearing. That, of course, is the controversial practice that Robinhood and other brokers use, where they send retail trades to market makers like Citadel Securities, and they get paid to send those orders there. Now, not surprisingly, and as you heard, Ken Griffin of Citadel Securities, he defended that practice, and so did Robinhood. They said that, listen, this is a good thing for customers because trading is now basically free, if not actually free. But lawmakers did raise some concerns about conflict of interest, whether or not high-speed traders are actually going ahead of retail traders. And so I think the question, Julia, is whether or not this leads to any new regulation, any new legislation. And if it does, that, of course, would be a concern for some of the key players involved.
Yeah, it's a great point. And I think the Robinhood CEO was also grilled on the point that he made of the $35 billion in unrealized and realized gains on top of investments that participants using the Robinhood platform have used. And a gain isn't a gain if it's unrealized, but it was an interesting point to make. And you raise it, Matt. Is there going to be concrete action after this? Because both the Robinhood CEO and Citadel CEO Ken Griffin said in their opening statements, there are ways that we can make the system more efficient and actually very quickly. And there's very little attention been paid to that. And that is transparency in some of the clearinghouses and reducing the time it takes to do a trade and then settle the trade, which requires a lot of cash. And actually, that was one of the big challenges that took place during this frenzy.
Right, that's right, Julia. There has been some talk, including in the remarks today, where, you know, there's this push to sort of try to modernize the system and try to speed up what is known as T+2. And that's where there's a trade and it takes 2 days to settle that trade. And because of that system, Robinhood has said that they had to put up vast amounts of capital. And that is why they say that they had to impose these trading restrictions. And so Vlad Tenev, the CEO of Robinhood, has said that, listen, there's no reason why we can't move to a real-time settlement system where there would be less friction, less need to put up that money, and perhaps less restrictions during times of volatility. But Julia, what's interesting is there really hasn't been all that much in-depth conversation about this idea of real-time settlement. There's been more focus on Robinhood's communications, payment for order flow, and issues like that, rather than real-time settlement.
Yeah. And actually, that would, to your point, reduce some of the frictions. And actually, very little heard from Roaring Kitty as well, who I was really looking forward to. But he did say he would be buying GameStop still today, even at these prices. So, yes, we'll see if we get action or if any action is required. Matt Egan, thank you so much for that.